We reported exclusively this week on these wanted posters that have turned up in Charlotte, North Carolina. We have blurred out the photos and exact names and addresses of the doctors who are targeted by these posters. But I can assure you, having seen the originals, that the information here is very specific. Three of the four doctors in question are pictured on these wanted posters. Their exact office addresses are listed. And in one case, a doctor's home address is given as well. The emergence of these wanted posters targeting doctors who provide abortions has sent a shockwave through the abortion rights world, because this hasn't happened for a long time. It used to happen a lot. Before Dr. David Gunn was murdered, there was a wanted poster out targeting him. Before Dr. John Britton was murdered, there was a wanted poster out targeting him. Dr. George Tiller was murdered last year, but before he was shot the first time in 1993, it's believed this wanted poster was targeting him was being circulated. In the mid-90s, this poster was distributed nationwide by a group calling itself the American Coalition for Life Activists. It contained names and, in most cases, addresses for 13 doctors who were providing abortions around the country at the time. You'll notice that Dr. George Tiller is on the list, along with his home address. The information from that poster and others like it was also listed on an extremist anti-abortion website titled The Nuremberg Files, the contention being that any doctor performing abortions in America was a Nazi war criminal. You can still find shadow versions of the Nuremberg Files website online today. The site listed, as this version still does, names of doctors who provide abortions, and in some cases much more detailed information about how to identify and find those doctors. The names of doctors who were murdered had a line drawn through them on the website. The murdered doctors were crossed out. The names of doctors who had been injured or maimed by anti-abortion extremists, their names appeared in gray, like they were, you know, almost dead, on their way. Some of the doctors targeted by that website and that wanted poster decided to fight back in court, contending that the pattern of violent attacks and assassinations of abortion providers in this country meant that putting them on wanted posters constituted a threat under the, at the time, new Freedom of Access to Clinic Entrances law. That argument is not exactly a leap of logic, right? But when the doctors won the case and when their victory was ultimately upheld by the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, it was seen as a landmark decision. When the anti-abortion activists appealed further, the Supreme Court declined to hear the case. And at that point, after that decision on behalf of the doctors being targeted by this wanted poster, it became clear legal precedent that this kind of tactic was legally off limits, that the extreme anti-abortion forces in this country would no longer be able to do stuff like this. And yet we are told by the folks at the Feminist Majority Foundation who have been tracking this that these wanted posters started appearing in North Carolina almost immediately after George Tiller was murdered last year. Joining us now for the interview is Dr. Elizabeth Newhall. She was one of the doctors targeted by the so-called Deadly Dozen poster. She practices medicine in Oregon. Dr. Newhall, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Rachel. I'm a big fan.
Well, thank you. Well, first, let me just ask you about what's going on right now in North Carolina. What's your reaction to seeing this wanted poster tactic being used against abortion providers again? Same thing that was used to threaten you in the 90s.
You know, threatening physicians from providing health care is illegal, immoral, unethical, all of the above. I confess I wasn't really aware of the new posters until I heard about them today from the Feminist Majority, and of course, realizing that this is ongoing and that there are, in fact, connections between the murderers is certainly unsettling, to say the least.
When that Deadly Dozen poster, that so-called Deadly Dozen poster, first came out, did you immediately see your name being on that poster as a threat, a physical threat to you?
Yes, ma'am. I will tell you, the day before, we heard that this tactic was going to be proposed, and a dear friend of mine was very much harassed by Operation Rescue, and we had a service at the Unitarian Church the day before to commemorate Dr. Gunn and other providers that had been killed, and I'm thinking, don't let it be Sue, don't let it be Sue, don't let it be Sue, and the next night the FBI called me up, is how I found out, and offered to send a federal marshal to my house, and could they send the police to put in silent alarms, and so on and so forth. That's how I found out when the FBI called me.
Did you accept a lot of that protection? How did being on that poster change your life?
I was living with my three children at that time, all of whom were teenagers. We had silent police alarms in our house, which, as I say, a little unsettling nonetheless. I didn't have a federal marshal. I didn't want that kind of intrusion, really. Not an intrusion, but I wore disguises. Friends gave me different cars. I never park in underground parking lots. We had to put in bulletproof glass. We were in the middle of doing medical abortion studies at the time. And we were doing our research while they were putting in bulletproof glass and steel gauge doors, and the doctor is arriving in a disguise with a bulletproof vest. It was a little unreal, surreal, to say the least.
Do you still feel like you're a target? When we called you today to talk to you about doing this interview, we had no idea whether or not you would feel comfortable being on television, whether you'd feel comfortable being identified. Do you still feel like you're under threat?
I think we're all under threat every day, anyone who provides abortion services. As I've said before, though, I'm much more frightened by a world where women don't have reproductive freedom than I am personally. I really believe that this is excellent medicine. This is mandatory for public health and for women's health and all of our health, children's health. Women have abortions because they care about motherhood. I don't think people really realize that. And so I am, I suppose, yes, frightened, and yes, determined to continue to provide women health care.
Do you see a future in America in which doctors aren't at risk for getting shot at and threatened and conceivably murdered anymore? Can you imagine a future in which this gets better?
Yes, I absolutely can. And thank you for the question, because I believe that as long as we marginalize abortion care and it's provided solely in clinics where everybody knows your business there, then targets are easily are made. If we incorporated abortion care into general gynecology, if you went to your gynecologist for a perf surgery or a medical abortion instead of to a clinic, we wouldn't have this problem at all. Services would be invisible. So I call upon my colleagues to provide the service. That's what the problem is. We have allowed, you know, we were so happy to have abortion made available in the early 70s, and the clinics were initially a feminist boon. But when the violence started and when the targeting started, I believe the correct answer is for physicians to provide services everywhere and for this to be a private issue between a woman and her physician in a place where nobody knows what she's there for.
It shouldn't be inconceivable. It shouldn't at all. Dr. Elizabeth Newhall, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I know it's not an easy decision to speak out at times like this, so thank you. I really appreciate it.
You too, Rachel. Thank you.
Thanks.